Gracious God and most merciful Father, you have granted us the rich and precious jewel of your holy word. Assist us with your Spirit, that the same word may be written in our hearts to our everlasting comfort, to reform us, to renew us according to your own image, to build us up and edify us into the perfect dwelling place of your Christ, sanctifying and increasing in us all heavenly virtues. Grant this, O Heavenly Father, for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Today we're going to be focusing on the background of the life of Jesus. Well, we begin with a little bit of the intertestamental history that prepares the way for the coming of Jesus. You know, the time in which Jesus lived was a major transition. It was a transition from a predominantly Jewish culture to a predominantly Greek culture. A transition from a predominantly Hebrew and Aramaic language to a predominantly Greek language. The philosophy was changing as well. Instead of a Hebraic background for this land, it was becoming more Hellenistic, and all of this set the stage then for the New Testament and the ministry of Jesus. But we pick up the intertestamental history with the ministry of Malachi, the last of the Old Testament prophets, around 431 BC. After Malachi, we come to a period of decline in the Persian rule and the conquest by Alexander the Great. In 334 BC, he conquered Persia and established a great Greek empire. After his death, his empire was divided among his generals. His sons were ruled to be incompetent, and so we have the beginning of the Ptolemy rule from Alexandria, and this was from Egypt. The Ptolemies ruled until about 198 BC, when they were defeated by the Seleucids, and Seleucids began to rule over Palestine from Antioch. Probably the most infamous of the Seleucid rulers was Antiochus Epiphanes, who ruled 175 to 163. In 167, he decided that he wanted to bring Greek culture to Jerusalem, and he was going to do that by setting up an altar to himself in the Jewish temple. He believed that he was the incarnation of Zeus, and so he wanted to be worshipped there in the Jerusalem temple. Well, there were some Jewish leaders that thought this was wrong, and they began a revolt. Mattathias and his sons revolted. This became known as the Maccabean Revolt. Mattathias from Modane and his sons, including Judas Maccabee, revolted. For 3 years they fought against the Seleucid rule, and eventually they overcame it. They went back to Jerusalem, they tore down the altar that had been dedicated to Zeus, and they re-established true worship there in Jerusalem. The feast that followed that deliverance was called Hanukkah, the Festival of Lights, because of the miracle that took place. They only had enough oil to light the menorah to have it burn for a day. But in fact, it burned for 8 days, and so we have the 8 days celebration of the Feast of Lights or Hanukkah, the feast of rededicating the temple. This is actually mentioned in John 10:22, where Jesus was in Jerusalem for this celebration in the winter of AD 32, just before his spring crucifixion. The Maccabees descendants ruled in the land after the Maccabean revolt, and these were known as the Hasmoneans. So, we have a period of Hasmonean rule, and there's a variety of different Hasmoneans who ruled, but by the time we come to 63 BC, we find that the rule passes from the Jewish leaders to the Romans, and Pompey conquered Jerusalem and Palestine, the land of Israel, fell under Roman domination. There were various people in charge of the land at this time. There was a governor by the name of Antipater, and he was murdered, and his two sons, Herod, and his brother Phasael, were appointed as co-rulers of Judea. In 40 BC, the Parthians invaded, swept into the land. Herod fled. He headed to Rome, where he sought refuge and asked the Roman Senate to give him the title, King of the Jews. And they did. They gave him that title, and he then returned to Palestine in 40 BC. He raised an army, he captured Jerusalem in 37 BC, and became the undisputed ruler of Judea, with the title given to him by the Romans, King of the Jews. The ironic thing is that he wasn't Jewish, he was Edomite, a descendant of Esau, rather than of Jacob. He began his rule in 37 BC over the land, and Herod is known for his great building project. He built the city of Caesarea on the sea. He rebuilt the city of Samaria, named it for the emperor Sebaster Caesar. He built a great fortress at Masada. He built a fortress just south of Jerusalem at a place that he named after himself, Herodion. It was later there that he was buried. Of course, he built the magnificent Jerusalem temple. It was said in those days, if you hadn't seen the Jerusalem temple, you hadn't seen a beautiful thing. Herod was plagued with all kinds of domestic troubles. He had 10 wives, and that will cause you a lot of problems any way you look at it. All of these wives wanted their children to succeed Herod as king, and so there was a lot of sibling rivalry. Herod ended up murdering several of his own children, and had his favorite wife Miriam executed because he suspected her guilty of adultery. It was toward the end of Herod's life that Jesus, the promised one, was born in Bethlehem. That's usually dated about 5 or 4 BC. Herod died in Jericho in the spring of 4 BC, so we know that Jesus was born before that time, before the spring of 4 BC. The Emperor Augustus, after Herod's death, divided his kingdom into three parts and assigned it to his three surviving sons. Archelaus was appointed the ruler of Judea, Idumea, and Samaria. Antipas was given the title of Tetrarch and was given the territories of Galilee and Perea. Herod Philip was appointed Tetrarch, or ruler of a people in the area northeast of the Sea of Galilee. You might be a little bit confused by the fact that Jesus was born probably 4 or 5 BC. How did that happen? Well, the present Christian era is a dating system that was invented by a Scythian monk who was living in Italy at the request of Pope Saint John in 525 AD. This monk modified the Alexandrian system of dating, which was based upon the reign of Diocletian, the persecutor of the church. He prepared a numbering system from the incarnation of our Lord Jesus. He placed the birth of Jesus at 753 years before the foundation of the city of Rome. But he failed to take into account that the gospel records that Jesus was born under King Herod, who died in 750 years before the foundation of the city of Rome. So, he was about 3 or 4 years off. The dating was questioned in the 8th century, actually rejected in the 9th century, but tradition had been established, and nobody wanted to change their calendars, and so today we find that our actual calendar system is about 4 years, 3.5 or 4 years off. That provides a little background then for the beginning of Jesus's ministry, which is recorded for us in 4 Gospels. 3 of these Gospels are called Synoptic Gospels, and the Synoptic Gospels, the word synoptic means to see together as. So, Matthew, Mark, and Luke are the Synoptic Gospels, and they see parallel events in the life of Jesus. They see the same basic story of the life of Jesus. The Gospel of John is different. It doesn't parallel Matthew, Mark, or Luke, and so it's a gospel unique to itself. But we have the 3 Synoptic Gospels and then the Gospel of John. They were written to different groups of people at different times and with different ideas and purposes in mind, so it's helpful as we begin our study of the life of Jesus to know and to be familiar with these gospel writers. Well, Matthew addresses the Jews, and his gospel is probably the first gospel to have been written. Mark addresses the Romans, and his gospel is probably the third gospel to have been written about AD 65 to 70. Luke addresses the Greek readers, and it's probably the second gospel dated around AD 60. John is the universal gospel, addressing his gospel to all humanity, and probably written as the last of the gospel writers around AD 85 to 90, although some interesting arguments have been made which would date John's gospel around AD 70. In Matthew, Jesus is presented as king. He is presented as the king who has come to claim his kingdom. Mark focuses on Jesus as the servant of the Lord, he came to serve. Luke highlights the fact that Jesus is the Son of Man, and he fulfills the prophecy of Daniel 7:13. The Son of Man who came to receive from God the Father, kingdom, rule, and authority. The Gospel of John presents Christ as the Son of God, really highlights the deity of Jesus as illustrated by his miracles. Matthew's purpose is to demonstrate to the Jewish readers that Jesus is the Messiah of Old Testament prophecy. So, we have many quotations from the Old Testament that highlight that truth. Mark seeks to present that Jesus is God's servant attested by his mighty miracles, his works. Luke shows that the life of Jesus is there to present a message of salvation and to save lost humanity, so there's real emphasis on saving humanity. The Gospel of John presents the orthodox doctrine of the Son of God, inspiring faith and life in him. The theme of Matthew is captured in the words that were placed upon the cross, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Mark's theme is captured in Mark 10:45, "The Son of Man came not to be served but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many." In Luke's Gospel, I believe the theme is captured in 19:10, "The Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost," real emphasis on salvation. I believe the theme of John's Gospel is captured in 20:31, "Believe in Jesus the Messiah and Son of God." 2 things John wants us to know is that Jesus is the promised Messiah and the Son of God. In terms of their design, Matthew's Gospel is more dispensational. It highlights the fact that God has worked in different economies over the age, with the economy of the Old Testament law, and moving into the New Covenant, which highlights God's great theme of grace and on into the kingdom. The focus in Mark's Gospel and its design is more chronological. Jesus did this and then he did that, then he did this, a real highlight on chronology. Luke's Gospel is more historical. He writes as a historian. He says that his Gospel was researched. He didn't live at the time of Jesus or didn't interact personally with Jesus, so he's a researcher. He's gathering materials, putting it together in a historical document. John's Gospel is more theological by design. The style of Matthew is more methodical and massive. He gives us everything. Mark is more colloquial and concise. He's kind of the Reader's Digest version of the Gospel of Matthew. Luke's Gospel is more artistic and classical. He is a gifted writer and writes with a classical style. John's Gospel is more abstract. In the beginning was the Word, wow. You can think about that all day long, and the Word was with God and the Word was God. It's a profound gospel, the first 18 verses, the prologue, very profound. So much packed into this small section. The emphasis in Matthew's gospel is on discourses, so we find there the Sermon on the Mount, the Olivet Discourse. Mark's gospel emphasizes miracles. 18 of the 35 miracles that are recorded in the gospels appear in Mark's gospel, and it's got more of a concentration than any of the other gospels. Luke's gospel highlights the parables. There's 35 parables in Luke 19 of which are unique. John's Gospel presents the interviews and discourses, interview with Nicodemus, interview with the Samaritan woman, some unique interviews. In terms of Old Testament quotations, Matthew excels them all with 129 Old Testament quotations. It's pretty clear that Matthew is writing to a Jewish audience. Mark has 63 Old Testament quotations. Luke 67 and John 43. In terms of the prominent words in the Gospels, Matthew's prominent word is fulfill. This happened in order that it might be fulfilled. You see the emphasis on the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies. Mark's Gospel likes that word immediately. Immediately Jesus went and did this, and immediately he went and did that. It's a sequential word. Luke likes the phrase Son of Man, and 26 times that phrase appears in Luke's Gospel. John is very fond of the word believe 98 times that Greek word pistuo, believe appears in John's Gospel. These are some of the distinctives of the Gospels that we'll be looking at. The information that we can draw from these Gospels highlights different aspects of the person of Jesus Christ. Mark is going to emphasize chronology of events. Luke is going to emphasize some of the miracles and the healings of Jesus as a physician. Matthew wants to emphasize the Old Testament prophecies being fulfilled, and all of these Gospels give us different perspectives and greater understanding of the life of Jesus. It's like looking at the life of Jesus from the eyes of different witnesses, and they all tell us what is true about the life of Jesus. More than that, I want you to be familiar with the land of Israel, the land in which Jesus lived. It's an amazing thing that it's such a small land, about 150 miles north to south, but 50 miles east to west. We start at sea level at the Mediterranean Sea, we go to about 3,000 feet in elevation in the hills of Judea and Samaria. It's a small land, but it's very unique, and it was this place of all the places God could have chosen in the world, it was this land that he chose to reveal himself through the Lord Jesus Christ. I think it's important to understand a little bit about this land, and I want to introduce you to the land of Israel. Barjil Pixner, who was a Benedictine monk at the Dormition Abbey in Jerusalem, referred to the land of Israel as the fifth gospel. He says five gospels record the life of Christ, four you will find in books, one you'll find in the land they call holy. Read the fifth gospel and the world of the four will open up to you. Well, the land of Israel, it's a strategic land bridge. It's a very small land, but it's a strategic land bridge between the continents. If you think of Europe in the north and Africa in the south and Asia in the east, how would ancient peoples go from one continent to the other? Well, you've got a desert east of the land of Israel, you've got a sea west of the land of Israel. Israel forms a narrow land bridge through which ancient people had to pass to go from continent to continent. God chose to put Jesus and his ministry right in that central area where the nations would pass through, and Israel could be a light to the nations in that strategic land bridge. We can expand that thought with the concept of the Fertile Crescent, which is this fertile area. Abraham starts down at Ur, goes up to the north and Haran, and then south into the land of Canaan, and this is the land, once again, this land bridge in which God wanted to reveal himself, and Israel is right in the middle of that travel area. This Fertile Crescent land bridge between the continents. The name Israel is the land in which God gave his people, it's also called Palestine. Now the name Palestine originally was used by the Romans in an attempt to say that it was no longer the land of the Jews, it was the land of the Philistines. So, after the Romans conquered Jerusalem and took over this area, they said, "This is not the land of the Jews, this is the land of the Philistines," and that the derivation of the word Palestine. But until 100 years ago, the land was referred to as Palestine in a non-political sense. There were Palestinian Jews and Palestinian Arabs, and they were all Palestinians because they lived in this land that had been designated by the Romans, the land of Palestine, and the name really stuck. Today the Israelis refer to it as Eretz Israel, the land of Israel, and the name Palestine has become a very politically charged name taken by the Arab people who live in the land. Today Palestinians are uniquely the Arab people who live in the land, and there's Palestinian mausoleums, and there's Palestinian Christians living in the land. When I use the word Palestine, I'm not using it in a political sense, unless I specifically say that I am. I'm using it in the geographical sense as it was used in antiquity, the land of Israel. The land of Israel and the land of Palestine basically the same land. Now the land has some borders. The Mediterranean Sea is the border on the west, the Transjordan Desert the border on the east. On the north we've got the mountains of Lebanon and specifically Mount Hermon or Mount Hermon, and to the south, we have what is referred to as the Wadi El Arish, it called the River of Egypt, but we don't believe that's the Nile, but rather it's a river channel or riverbed just to the south of the Negev area, the Wadi El Arish. These are the borders that are given for the land. As I mentioned, the land is about 150 miles from Dan to Beersheba, and about 50 miles from the Mediterranean Sea to the Rift Valley. It's a pretty small land, but this is where Jesus lived and ministered and revealed God to us. The land of Israel is small land, it's such a little tiny place compared to our large country. The amazing thing is that if something happens in Jerusalem, you're going to read about it in the front page. If something happens in Miami or New York, you might not read about it. But what happens in Israel, even though it's a small land, is significant because remember, it's the land bridge between the continents. Even though you can fly over that land bridge today, it nevertheless is a strategic location and surrounded by the nations of the world. Four major geographical regions in the land. We've got the coastal plain on the west, the hill country going north and south through the land, kind of the central spine of the land. We've got the Rift Valley that follows the Jordan River from the Sea of Galilee down to the Dead Sea, and the Transjordan Highlands to the east. The coastal plain, you can see by this satellite view that the coastal plain of Israel is very straight going north. There's a little bump there though at Mount Carmel as Mount Carmel juts out into the Mediterranean Sea. Here's what the coastal plain looks like at the side of Tel Aviv, and you can see in this slide the modern city of Tel Aviv about in the central part of the picture on the coast. You can see a little bit of a hill, that's the hill of Jaffa or Joppa in the Old Testament, and a port from which Jonah set sail as he was fleeing the will of the Lord. The coastal plain is pretty straight, just heading north to Mount Carmel, and then bumping out a little bit, and then continuing on up to Phoenicia. Israel's hill country is really a spine, it's like the pressure around this area just kind of created a hill going right north and south through the land of Israel. That's the hill country. Now you think of hill country, you might think of a more mountainous area, but the hill country of Israel is not as mountainous as the Rocky Mountains or the Oregon Cascades. But when you get there you can see that there are hills there, and this is the central part of the land of Israel. A little closer view on the ground you can see there are these hills and valleys. It is a mountainous area, but not like the Rockies or the Cascades Mountains. Then we come to Israel's Rift, the Rift Valley. The Rift Valley starts in the mountains of Lebanon, goes through the Bekaa Valley down into the land of Israel, the Sea of Galilee, the Jordan River, the Dead Sea, and then the Rift Valley continues on to the Red Sea, and actually extends into Africa. So, this is a huge break in the Earth's crust. Basically, separates Israel from the Transjordan area to the east. The Transjordan Highlands extend north and south paralleling the Rift Valley, and these are a little bit higher. These mountains go up to 4,000 to 5,000 feet in elevation, whereas Israel's mountains max out at about 3,000 feet. Here we can look across the Dead Sea to those Transjordan Highlands, and we've got the state of Jordan over there with the Transjordan. This is the area that is to the east of the Rift Valley. There are three major travel routes that go through the land of Israel. We've got along the coast the International Coastal Highway that actually goes from Egypt through the land of Israel on to Damascus and continues on north. Then we've got a smaller route, the Central Ridge Route, that goes north and south from the Negev area in the south, up to the area of the Jezreel Valley. Then we've got the Transjordan Highway. There are smaller routes that interconnect these three major routes, but these are the three major travel routes through the land of Israel. As you study the Bible, you can find the patriarchs traveling on this central ridge route. You can find Pharaoh Necho going up the International Coastal Highway and the Transjordan Highway used by the Queen of Sheba when she comes to visit Solomon. These highways, these roads are referred to in scripture. Nazareth, which is a very large city today, was a small village of about 150 to 200 people in the time of Jesus. This is where the angel Gabriel announced to Mary that she was going to be the mother of the promised one. The Jordan River, where Jesus was baptized by John the Baptizer and began his public ministry. The wilderness, the Judean wilderness, where Jesus was tempted to turn the stones of the wilderness into bread. the Jerusalem temple, Jesus went up to Jerusalem, cleansed the temple, and he cast out the money changers and sheep salesmen from the temple area. This was the temple that had been refurbished by King Herod and beautified, so that it was a beautiful place. A large plaza there for both Jews and Gentiles to come together and to worship. The Gentiles could not go past the barrier, a fence around the central part of the temple. That barrier was the dividing wall that separated the Jews from the Gentiles. Gentiles could not go past that barrier, and if they did, they would be responsible for their own deaths which would ensue. Capernaum, a 4th century synagogue built over the earlier 1st century synagogue. You can actually see the foundation of the 1st century synagogue at Capernaum. This was the site where Jesus gave his bread of life discourse in John 6, where it says, "These things Jesus spoke in the synagogue at Capernaum." You can stand in that synagogue today. A later synagogue built over the earlier synagogue where Jesus ministered. The Mount of the Beatitudes, a traditional place where Jesus gave his Sermon on the Mount. Jesus would often rise up early in the morning to spend time with his Heavenly Father. We want to show some chronological highlights of the life of Jesus. We can pin some dates on some key events in the life of Jesus. I have suggested that his birth took place sometime around 54 BC, the birth of Jesus around 54 BC. We can date that pretty accurately. Then we've got the beginning of his ministry at his baptism, probably the summer or autumn of AD 29, when he was immersed in the Jordan River, and he began his public ministry. We can date his first temple cleansing, the Passover that followed his baptism in AD 30, April 7, AD 30. There are some other dates we can pin down, like the Feast of Tabernacles that Jesus attended recorded in John 5, the feeding of the 5,000 recorded in John 6, and that was just a year before Jesus went up to Jerusalem for Passover, so that was AD 32, and in AD 33, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for the Passover and his own Passion. We know that he was in Jerusalem during the winter of AD 32. We have a reference in John 10:22 to Jesus attending the Feast of Dedication. We have his arrival in Bethany in the spring, March 28 of AD 33. We can actually date his royal entry. It was Monday rather than Sunday. Tradition places it on Sunday, but it was actually Monday, March 30, AD 33, that Jesus came into Jerusalem in fulfillment of prophecy riding on the colt of a donkey. Passover followed, and then the trial and crucifixion of Jesus, April 3, AD 33. His resurrection followed on Sunday, April 5 of AD 33, and his ascension from the Mountain of Olives 40 days later, that would be May 14, AD 33. Some have wondered if Jesus was born 54 BC, how old was he when he died? Well, Luke 3:23 indicates that Jesus was about 30 at his baptism. Oftentimes this is misunderstood, and it's thought that he was 30 at his baptism, but it says he was about 30. He lived 3 years before AD 1 and 32 years after AD 1 to AD 33. This adds up to about 35, perhaps maximum 36 years old at his death. We have attempted to set a little bit of historical and literary background as the context for the life of Jesus. Next, we want to focus on 12 major events in the life of Jesus that summarize what went on in the life of our Savior. So, we are going to be following Matthew's Gospel as we consider the life of Jesus. We begin with the birth of Jesus, the virgin birth. The birth of Jesus is the most significant event in human history, and it really divides history. The most unusual thing about Jesus's birth is that he was born without a human father. It was a virgin birth. Matthew records that before Joseph and Mary had come together as a married couple, Mary was found to be pregnant. Matthew 1:18 says, "Before they came together, she was found to be with child by the Holy Spirit." Now there were two avenues open to Joseph at this time. He could involve himself in a public lawsuit, defame Mary for breaking the betrothal relationship, or he could set her aside quietly by a divorce. Joseph, being a righteous man, chose the latter. But as he was contemplating this decision, we find that the angel spoke to him and told him that this child was not as a result of the illegitimate relationship that Mary had involved herself with, but this child has been conceived of the Holy Spirit. His name is to be called Jesus. A name means salvation. Jesus means salvation. So, his name, in keeping with what he is going to do. He will provide salvation for his people. And then Matthew quotes from Isaiah 7:14, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. This is the first of a long line of prophecies that Matthew will quote to show that Jesus is the long-expected Messiah, the long-expected promised one of Israel. The virgin birth testifies to the uniqueness of Jesus and verifies that he is truly the Son of God born of a virgin. His birth is recorded in Matthew 1:25. He kept her, Joseph kept her a virgin until she gave birth to a son, and he called his name Yeshua, which is Hebrew for Jesus. So, human history, divided by this important event, the virgin birth of our Savior Jesus. The next event is his approval at his baptism. Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River near a place where the Israelites had crossed into Canaan under the leadership of Joshua. Now immersion was a common cleansing ritual in Judaism. So John was down by the Jordan River immersing people in the river. They were familiar with his common cleansing ritual. But Jesus didn't need any ritual cleansing, and Matthew tells us why he was baptized in Matthew 3:15. He was baptized to fulfill all righteousness. John objected to him baptizing Jesus. He said, "I'm not worthy to untie your sandal," but Jesus said, "Let's do it at this time, for it is to fulfill all righteousness." It fulfills righteousness in that the baptism is the right thing to do. It's what was necessary. It was in conformity with God's will. It was the right thing to do. It fulfilled all righteousness. But we also see it was for empowerment. After being baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens opened, and he saw the Spirit of God descending as a dove and lighting upon him. Several Jewish writings refer to the dove as a symbol of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit took the physical form of a dove and descended upon Jesus. At his baptism, Jesus received a special anointing by the Holy Spirit to carry on his earthly ministry. This is mentioned in Acts 10:38 that Jesus was empowered by the Spirit as the Spirit came upon him. Peter mentions this in his sermon in Acts 10:38. The third reason for his baptism is to signify his acceptance by God. This is the first of three times when God the Father spoke from heaven, and here in verse 3:17 we read, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." So Jesus was said to be accepted by God, and God was pleased with him at his baptism. The baptism was really the initiation into Jesus' public ministry. After his baptism, we find that Jesus was proven through his temptation in Matthew 4. Now notice the circumstances in Matthew 4. We have Jesus being led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. So this temptation was initiated by the Holy Spirit, that the instrument of temptation was Satan himself. God's purpose in the temptation was to show Christ's sinlessness through his obedience to the Father's will, as he refused the temptations offered him. Satan's purpose, on the other hand, was to make Jesus sin by taking shortcuts to the accomplishment of his messianic purposes. So let's look at these temptations briefly. The first temptation after Jesus had fasted 40 days and 40 nights was to turn the stones of the wilderness into bread. Jesus was there in the wilderness trusting God the Father. That's what fasting is all about. He was trusting God for strength and energy to survive. Satan said, "Stop trusting God. You can use your own power. You can use your own power to make bread and create bread to meet your needs." Well, Jesus resisted that temptation. He said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but on every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." There was something more important to Jesus than bread, and that was his relationship with the Father. In the second temptation, Jesus is taken to the temple and told by Satan, "Cast yourself off the pinnacle of the temple. God will send his angels to protect you from the fall." Satan was asking Jesus to demonstrate his supreme faith in God by testing God's faithfulness by throwing himself off the pinnacle of the temple. To throw himself off the pinnacle would involve the test of God's faithfulness, and it would show a lack of sincere trust in God. You don't need to test someone you truly trust. Jesus was trusting God, and he didn't need to test God or test God's faithfulness, so he refused this temptation. The third temptation was an offer to take a shortcut to the kingdom. Satan said, "You know you can take a shortcut. You don't have to go to the cross to get the crown. Just worship me and I'll give you all the kingdoms of the earth." But Jesus refused that temptation. He said, "God alone is worthy of worship. You shall not worship anyone except the Lord God alone." Well, Jesus refused these temptations, and by refusing the temptations, he demonstrated that he was truly qualified to serve as the Messiah and Son of God. He quotes scripture to show that what Satan was asking him to do was contrary to God's will, and the temptation of Jesus sets him forth as the perfect Son of God and settled forever the question of Jesus's sinlessness. Jesus is sinless as the Savior, and therefore he is fully qualified to be our Lamb of God and take our sins upon himself because he was perfectly sinless. In Matthew 4, we come to the next key event in the life of Jesus, and that is his offer of the kingdom. Matthew 4:17. From that time on after his temptation, Jesus begins to preach and say, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Now the word repent means change your mind. What does Jesus want them to change about their thinking? Jesus was telling those who would listen, don't be deceived, being Jewish doesn't mean you'll be saved and have a place in the kingdom. You have to be born again, that's what Jesus told Nicodemus. Jesus was saying repent of these wrong views, return from these wrong views, and find your salvation in me, rather than in your traditions or your physical descent from Abraham. That's not good enough to get you in the kingdom, you must be born again. Now what is the kingdom of God? I'm going to define the kingdom of God as God's people in God's place under God's rule. It's a spiritual reality that will ultimately be realized in physical form. The kingdom is now, but it's not now as it will one day be when Jesus returns and establishes his rule on the throne of David. So there's a present aspect to the kingdom, and there's a future aspect. The prophets told the people of Israel that the kingdom would be a time of peace and prosperity and justice and blessing. Isaiah predicted that the people who are blind would see, the people who were deaf would hear, the people who were mute would speak, and the lame would walk, Isaiah 35:5 to 6. You can imagine how the people were longing for and looking forward to the arrival of God's kingdom. So Jesus was announcing that the time had come to accept him as the king, and to enter into his kingdom. Repent of our views, Jesus was saying, and accept me as your promised one, the one who comes as your king and savior. How was Jesus to prove that he was the Messiah? We're studying the life of a man who claimed to be God. He claimed to be the promised Messiah whom the Jews had long anticipated. He came to offer his kingdom to those who would receive him by faith, but many people, understandably, were skeptical. What would it take to convince them that Jesus's claims were valid? Jesus didn't carry any official documents proving that he was the Messiah, but he did present some credentials that were intended to authenticate him as God's son and Israel's Messiah. Jesus's official credentials are his miracles, they are the credentials of King Jesus. The miracles of Jesus were not designed merely to arrest attention or to gain a following, they served to authenticate that Jesus was the Son of God, and he brought God's message to the people of Israel. His preaching and teaching were usually followed by a miracle. His works served to validate the truth of his words, and we see that in Matthew 4:23, Jesus was going through all Galilee teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every kind of disease and every kind of sickness. Why was Jesus healing? Well, he was validating his claims, he was authenticating his offer of the kingdom through his miracles. The miracles of Jesus are the insignia of his deity and messiahship. Well, we come to a key turning point in Matthew 12:22 32. Here Matthew records the rejection of Jesus by the Jewish religious leaders. Jesus had done a miracle, he liberated a man from demon possession, and the multitude was amazed. The evidence of the miracle pointed to the fact that Jesus was the Messiah. But the unbelief of the Jewish religious leaders was confusing. They can't deny that a miracle has taken place, so in desperation, they accused Jesus of doing his miracle by the power of Satan. They were saying, in fact, your credentials are not of heaven, your credentials are straight from hell. They were saying that Jesus was associated with Satan himself, Matthew 12:24, this man casts out demons only by Beelzebub, the ruler of demons. If this view prevailed, Jesus would be rejected, and the kingdom would have to be postponed. So, Jesus responded to the religious leaders by telling them that they had committed a sin, an unpardonable sin. The evidence of his miracles pointed to the fact that Jesus was the Messiah and the kingdom was at hand, and the Pharisees couldn't deny the fact of the miracle. Their desperate attempt to turn people away from Jesus was simply to say that Jesus was doing his miracles by the power of Satan. So, Jesus said, I say to you, any sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven people, but blasphemy against the Holy Spirit shall not be forgiven. So, this is the unpardonable sin by the Jewish religious leaders that set the nation of Israel on the course of rejecting their Messiah. This is a key turning point in the life of Jesus. Things are going to be different from this point on. Now Jesus is going to be teaching his disciples through parables, and he's going to start preparing his disciples for his impending death. It all hinges on what happened here in Matthew 12:22 32, a key turning point in Matthew's gospel, as the religious leaders set the course for the nation of Israel in their rejection of Jesus. No wonder Jesus said this is an unpardonable sin, it's so unique that it's unpardonable, because this generation of religious leaders had turned Messiah's people against him, and that unique sin would never be forgiven. So, what did Jesus do after this? Well, he began teaching through parables. With his rejection by the Jewish religious leaders, the disciples had some important questions about the kingdom. They wondered what's going to happen to God's kingdom program? Has the kingdom been cancelled? How is God going to deal with believers until his kingdom purposes are accomplished? Well, Jesus started answering those questions for his disciples through his teaching of the parables. Now the parables disclose some new truths about God's kingdom as it will develop during this present age, during this time of Israel's rejection of their Messiah. The parables teach how God's kingdom will grow spiritually during this inter-Advent age between Jesus' first coming and his second coming, between his rejection by Israel and his future acceptance by Israel. The parables revealed that God's kingdom purposes will not be thwarted by Israel's rejection of their Messiah. Like the mustard seed, the kingdom will start small, but it will grow to great proportions. Like the leavening, the process, the kingdom will grow by an internal dynamic, rather than by some great outward organization. Like a great treasure, the kingdom of God is worth pursuing. It is worth pursuing at whatever cost, at whatever sacrifice. So, Jesus was teaching his disciples about the kingdom, the present kingdom, through parables. He calls these teachings the mysteries of the kingdom, things that had not been revealed in the Old Testament about the kingdom, but were being revealed now by Jesus about the kingdom. As the end of Jesus's life drew near, Jesus was beginning to prepare his disciples for his death, and he began to announce to them his death. Jesus had announced his death in Matthew 16:21. From that time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things from the elders, the chief priests and the scribes, and be killed and raised up on the third day. Well, Peter feared that Jesus's death would prevent the establishment of the kingdom, and the transfiguration is really designed to deal with that issue. Can Jesus be king if he dies? Will Jesus's death prevent his establishment of the kingdom? The transfiguration took place on Mount Hermon, 9,200 feet in elevation. Jesus is said to have morphed, transfigured himself, a change from the inside out. It was as if the inner glory of Christ radiated out through his human flesh, and Peter, James and John saw the glory of God on the mountain of transfiguration. It was witnessed by Peter and by John, both of them mention it in their writings. Moses the great lawgiver and Elijah the prophet appeared there with Jesus on the mountain of transfiguration, and they were talking with Jesus about his exodus, about his death. The presence of these two great figures of the past demonstrates that departure from this world would not hinder the establishment of the Messiah's kingdom. Moses, who had died, was there, Elijah, who had been taken to heaven, was there. Departure from this earth would not hinder the establishment of the kingdom. Christ's death would not mean an end to the kingdom hope, and his death would not prevent the establishment of his kingdom rule on earth. God the Father spoke a second time from heaven, "This is my beloved Son, hear him, pay attention to what he is saying." Next, we have the royal entry of Jesus. He came in the prescribed way according to Zechariah 9:9, riding on the colt of a donkey. And on the very prophesied day according to Luke 19:42, the events following the royal entry constitute the official response of the nation to the official presentation of the Messiah as king. I call it the royal entry, rather than the triumphal entry, because I think the triumphal entry will be at his second advent as recorded in Revelation 19. This is his royal entry. It took place on Monday rather than Sunday. Monday was the 10th of Nisan. This was the very day that the Passover lamb was to be selected for sacrifice. It was on this day that Jesus was presented to his people Israel as their true Passover lamb. He came into Jerusalem riding on a royal mount, the colt of a donkey, in fulfillment of Zechariah 9:9. As Jesus approached the city, the people showed him honor by spreading their garments before him, and cutting palm branches, and laying them down before him. Then they quoted from Psalm 118, they shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna to the King. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." The word Hosanna means save now, and they were rejoicing because the Messiah had come, and they were asking him to save them now from Roman rule, from Roman oppression. They weren't so much interested in spiritual salvation as they were interested in physical deliverance. Well, the Pharisees were upset because the disciples were crying out, "Hosanna, Hosanna," and so they thought that Jesus should silence the people because they were crying out for deliverance from Roman rule, and if that cry continued, the Romans would come down and punish them for it. Jesus responded, "If these people are silent, the very stones will cry out." He said, "If you had known this day and the things that are meant for peace." Jesus had come into Jerusalem in the very fulfillment of prophecy, riding on the colt of a donkey, and fulfilling the precise chronology of Daniel 9, coming on the exact day that was predicted by Daniel 9. No wonder Jesus said, "If you had known this day, not tomorrow, not the next day, but this day, then you would have recognized the Messiah." The same group that had welcomed Jesus to Jerusalem later that week would cry out for his crucifixion. While Jesus was on the cross, the land was enveloped by darkness, and the darkness, of course, was a symbol of divine judgment. It points to the divine judgment that Jesus bore on the cross as he took our sins upon himself. In verse 46 of Matthew 27, we come to what I believe is the most significant moment of redemptive history. About the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, saying in Aramaic, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which is translated for us by Matthew, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Of course, it comes exactly from Psalm 22:1. This was the time that Jesus bore the sins of humanity, those sins which the Old Testament sacrifices had only covered. Jesus bore our sins, the past sins, the present sins, and the future, as Paul says. He became sin for us on the cross, 2 Corinthians 5:21. At that time, the intimate fellowship which Jesus had enjoyed with the Father from eternity past, that intimate fellowship was broken. To pay the full penalty of man's sin and provide salvation, Jesus had to endure spiritual as well as physical death. I believe that the words that Jesus spoke, my God, why have you forsaken me, reflects his sense of spiritual separation from God, the one with whom he had had intimate fellowship from eternity past. And at the greatest moment of his spiritual agony, as he bore humanity's sin on himself, Jesus sought the presence of the Father and he reached out, and it was as if God the Father was not there. It was as if God the Father had abandoned his Son. It's too great to really fully understand and comprehend, but God was pouring out his wrath on Jesus, and Jesus was taking the wrath that we deserved upon himself. He felt forsaken by God. It's too great to fully comprehend or explain, but we believe it because Scripture teaches it, and we thank God for it. Notice in verse 50 of Matthew 27, no one took Jesus's life from him. Jesus laid down his life as a voluntary sacrifice. Jesus in verse 50, he cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. What did he say as he cried out? John 19:30 records what he said, "Tetelestai, it is finished, redemption has been accomplished." On the cross, Jesus offered himself as the perfect Passover lamb for the sins of the world, and he satisfied fully God's wrath on sinners, providing a way for all who would accept the gift of salvation to enter into a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ and experience forgiveness of sin and eternal life. Well, the death of Jesus was not the end of the story. Earlier in his ministry, Jesus announced there would be one last sign to the nation of Israel, a sign that would authenticate his messianic claims. Jesus called it the sign of Jonah, Matthew 12:39 and Matthew 16:4, as Jonah had been in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights, so Jesus would spend a similar time in the grave. Both stories, the story of Jonah and the story of Jesus, have a surprising ending. As Jonah was delivered from the fish, so Jesus was resurrected from the grave. Jesus's resurrection was the final authentication that he was whom he claimed to be, the Son of God, the Messiah of Old Testament prophecy. When visitors arrived at the tomb early in the morning, the angel announced, "He is not here, for he has risen just as he said." Later that morning, Mary, and then Peter, and then two of the disciples on the road to Emmaus, and then the 10 disciples in the upper room, saw their resurrected Jesus. They saw Jesus having been raised from the grave. The resurrection of Jesus was the final authentication that he was whom he claimed to be, the Son of God and the Messiah of Israel. That is attested to us by the Scripture. We, by reading the Scripture, have that witness to ourselves as well, that Jesus is the promised one, the Son of God and the Messiah. But there's more. You know, we celebrate the incarnation of Jesus, we remember his death and celebrate his resurrection, but little is done to commemorate his ascension, and yet this is an important event. The ascension was foretold by Isaiah the prophet, Isaiah 52:13. Luke anticipates Christ's ascension as the goal of his journey to Jerusalem, Luke 9:51. Jesus speaks of it in John 16:10 and 20:17. Jesus's return to the Father is the evidence of his righteousness. His acceptance back into heaven indicates that his holiness was not tarnished during his incarnation on earth. Jesus is the perfect standard of righteousness that God accepts and delights in. Angelical announcement accompanied Jesus's ascension into heaven in Acts 1:9. Jesus was lifted up, and the disciples were looking on, and a cloud received him out of their sight, and as they gazing intently into the sky where he was going, behold, two men clothed in white stood by them. "Men of Galilee, why are you standing looking into the sky? This Jesus who is taken from you up to heaven will come in just the same way as you have watched him go into heaven." The angels declared that Jesus was going to return. He would return in the same way in which he departed, physically, personally, and visibly. Jesus is coming again, and that's part of the good news of the gospel. Well, the Christian life is really what it's all about. It's all about Jesus, isn't it? It's all about getting to know him, living for him, serving him. Toward the end of the Apostle Paul's life, he wrote to the Philippians and said, "I count all things to be lost in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord." You know, Paul wasn't interested in just knowing about Jesus, he was interested in knowing him personally. he wanted to know him better and better. Let us pray. Accept, O Lord, our thanks and praise for all that you have done for us. We thank you for the splendor of the whole creation, for the beauty of this world, for the wonder of life, and for the mystery of love. We thank you for the blessing of family and friends, and for the loving care which surrounds us on every side. We thank you for setting us at tasks that demand our best efforts, and for leading us to accomplishments that satisfy and delight us. We thank you also for those disappointments and failures that lead us to acknowledge our dependence on you alone. Above all, we thank you for your Son Jesus Christ, for the truth of his word and the example of his life, for his steadfast obedience, by which he overcame temptation, for his dying, through which he conquered death, and for his rising to life again, in which we are raised to the life of your kingdom. Grant us the gift of your Spirit, that we may know Christ and make him known, and through him, at all times and in all places, may give thanks to you in all things. Amen.